Hey guys, hello, what's up? Welcome back to another amazing video of Technical Zone. You are watching Technical Zone and I am Umar. And welcome to the third episode of the Java programming series. This episode is going to be very informative. We are going to talk about Java comments, variables and also Java data types. I advise all of you to please watch this episode from the starting till the end. And here is a presentation which I have prepared for the purpose of easing explanation. Without a further ado, let's quickly begin. First, we have to discuss Java comments. Now, what is a comment? I'll quickly open BlueJ so that I can demonstrate everything as well. Here we are having BlueJ. It's an IDE, as I already told. Opening a program, you can see that this is a class. We have already discussed the working of this program in our previous episode. If you have, you guys have missed that, the link is there in the description below. I'll highly advise all of you to please watch that episode first and continue with this one later. Okay, so Java comments are basically the non-executable part of a Java program. The part of the Java program which is not going to be executed by the compiler and also not going to be interpreted by the interpreter is called Java comment. For example, if this is a program, then each and every line is being read and it is being understood by the compiler as well as the interpreter. But if I write here, let's say I write here, this is a hello world program, then this line of code is not understood by the Java virtual machine and it's going to throw an error. You can see it's throwing an error. The reason being, this is an English sentence and this is breaking the syntax of Java language, and because it is breaking the syntax of Java language, it's throwing an error. But for example, I'm sending this program to a person who is having no knowledge about Java, then how is he going to understand that this is a hello world program? I need to convey that this is a hello world program. So over here we are going to use comments. Now comments, as I already told, is the non-executable part of a Java program. Java virtual machine and the compiler is not at all concerned with how many comments we are having in the Java program and what we have written in the comment. It will simply ignore comments. I want that this line is not brought into execution so that it does not throw an error simply. I want this only for user reference. I don't want the machine to go through this. So I'll make it a comment. And how do I make comments? Let's quickly understand. Now Java comments, depending on the usage, are of three different categories. The first one being single line comments, next one being multi-line comments, and the last one being documentation comments. If I come on single line comments, simply a comment which is summarized in one line is called a single line comment. As you can see here, this is a single line comment. How do we make this a single line comment? It's yet not a single line comment. If we have to make this a single line comment, I'll put two backslashes here. Simply, I have got my single line comment, it is summarized in one line. Now what if it's there in two lines? Again, it's throwing an error. Now what I can do is, either I put two backslashes here and make it a single line comment, two single line comments. Else what I can do is, I can declare a multi-line comment. Multi-line comment, a comment which gets summarized in more than one lines is called a multi-line comment. How do we declare it? Let's understand the syntax. It's very easy to understand. Fine. Over here we are replacing one backslash with an asterisk, then coming here, putting an asterisk and then a backslash. And you can see our multi-line comment is ready. Howsoever I want to use it, maybe I want to use it in two lines, I want to add more lines of comment here, I want to write something here, I can. It's not going to throw any error. I can add as many lines I wish to, and whatever the length of these lines can be, it does not matter. Now, last but not the least, documentation comments. Documentation comment is the type of comment which deals with the documentation part of Java. Now, documentation comment is very similar to multi-line comment. The only difference being, it is dedicated for the purpose of documentation. It is dedicated for the purpose of storing the name of the programmer, the date on which the program is created, the errors which the program might throw, and the way the program has been made, or how many packages the program is having. And how do we declare a documentation comment? Simply, one more asterisk here, documentation comment is ready. A slash, two asterisks in the beginning, then comment whatever we have to write in how many lines we can, and then an asterisk and a slash at the end. and this is our documentation comment. Very easy and very simple to understand. I am quickly going to put three comments here. Firstly, let's make a documentation comment. I am writing something here, maybe A. Next, I am writing over here B. I am writing here C. You can see that this is a comment. It's not throwing an error. Now, declaring a multi-line comment. Okay, so a slash, an asterisk, one more asterisk, and a slash again. And I am putting here, let's say, A, B. Again, it's not throwing any error. Now, a single line comment. I am coming here and I am putting two slashes and I am writing A, B, C. Again, a comment throwing no error. So, you can see all the three types of comments here. Not throwing any error. Let's move on to the next. Next, we have Java variables. A comparatively difficult topic to understand. Let's quickly decode it. What is a variable? Variable refers to a reserved memory location in Java. For example, I am taking this box and I am saying that this box is a memory location in Java. I am saying that this is a memory location. This box is a memory location, fine. And I am storing something in this memory location. Let's say that I am storing in this memory location a value. Let's say I am storing here a value and let's say that value is 31. Fine, I am storing 31 in this memory location. Then this memory location in the terms of Java, when we are understanding Java, in Java we call this memory location a variable. So this memory address, this place reserved in the random access memory for storing number 31 is a variable in Java. Simple to understand. How do we refer to this memory location? I have stored 31. Let's say that I have stored 31 here. Fine. 31 is there stored in this memory location. Okay, stored. Now, how do we call this 31? So, we are going to assign this memory location a name. Let's say the name is number. The name which we have given to this memory location is number. So, whenever we are going to say number, then we are referring to this memory location only. Whenever in the program I will say number, I am referring to this memory location. In terms of Java, I am referring to this particular variable. Simple to understand. And this particular variable is storing the number 31. I am saying number in my program. Basically, I am invoking 31, which is stored in a reserved memory location. Moving on next. Last topic to discuss in this video is data types. Data types in Java. Now, let's quickly come back on paint and let's erase everything. Fine. I am just erasing everything and I am quickly going to tell that what do I mean by data type. Fine, data type. A data type in Java is a characteristic given to a memory location. A characteristic given to the variable is referred to as data type. Now, how will Java understand? I am just quickly writing two things here. Firstly, I am writing 31 and I am writing, rather I am typing 31252, a random number. Let's say this is the number. How will Java get to know? We as humans know that 31 requires comparatively less space. But how will Java get to know that 31 requires lesser space than this big number? Here we use data types. With the help of data type, we'll tell Java that 31 requires a smaller variable, whereas this number requires a comparatively bigger variable. This is told with the help of data types. Simple to understand. Now, if I come here, you can see two categories, primitive and non-primitive data types. Okay. Now, when we talk about data types, then either we can create a data type or we can bring into use data types which are already existing. Simple to understand. Non-primitive data types are the ones which are which we have to create. For example, objects, interfaces, array. These are comparatively complex topics. So, we'll discuss them in a separate video. Let's be concerned with primitive data types here. And yes, while referring to primitive data types, we also have to talk about two separate data types. I'll quickly make a flowchart here to ease understanding. Okay, fine. Now typing here primitive and non-primitive data types, rather typing here PR to represent primitive data types and typing NPR to represent non-primitive data types. NPR, non-primitive data types. And we are not concerned with non-primitive data types in this video at least, so we are simply going to ignore non-primitive data types. And today we are going to understand about primitive data types. If I talk about primitive data types, then these are this is that category of data types which is already declared. We just have to bring this into use. For example, int, float, byte, long, short, it's already there. We just have to use these keywords in our Java program so that we can define how much space a variable is going to take up. Simple. Now if I talk about primitive data types, then again they are of two categories. And these two categories are numeric data type and non-numeric data type. Numeric and non-numeric. As the name suggests, numeric data type deals with numbers, whereas non-numeric data types deals with, you can say, Boolean, you can say characters, you can even say string. Okay, now let's come to our flowchart. You are seeing int, long, double, short, byte, float, char, bool. What's the function? Okay, if I talk about numeric data types, I already told that this is that category which deals with numbers. And if we further want to bifurcate numeric data types, if I further want to talk about numeric data types, then I have to categorize it into four parts. What are those four parts? Let's quickly list them one by one. First is byte. Next is short. The third one being int or integer. Fourth one being long. And let's talk about the other category also. This is category number one. I'm putting this in one square. Category number one. Let's talk about category number two. Okay, drawing the box. I'm done. And writing here float and double. Fine. If I talk that what's the difference between this category and this category, simply it's about the decimal point. If your value is having a decimal point, you are going to bring into use this. If the value which you have given is not having a decimal point, then you are going to bring into use this. Byte, short, int, long. These four are there for whole numbers. This is there for decimal numbers. Fine. Now, again, the question arises, why these four different data types for representing numbers? If the number is small, then you use byte. If it is comparatively long, then short. If it is not getting accommodated in short, you are going to use int. And if it's a very large number, you are going to use long. Now, I know that this is a very generalized description which I've given of all these four things. But yes, because we are beginners, this is a new programming language which we are learning. We'll keep things simple. For now, let's understand it like this only, that these are four different data types. And if we want to store small numbers, we use byte. Comparatively longer ones, then we use short. Comparatively longer ones, again, in comparison to short, then we use int. And if numbers are very long, we use this word long, as it suggests. If we are having decimal numbers which are small, you can say simple to define, 3.7, 3.72, use float. If they are comparatively longer decimal numbers, like 3.645392, then use double. It's a very generalized description. I'll again say that there are technicalities to it. There are specific numeric ranges for each data type. There are also certain, you can say, terms which we use while defining these data types. But to keep things simple, again, I'll repeat, we are going to understand it like this only. Talking about non-numeric data types quickly. For now, we are going to talk about non-numeric data types. And there are only two categories which we are going to deal with. For now, I'll again say. And what are these two categories going to be? Quite interesting to understand. Fine. So one category is going to be of characters and the other one is going to be of boolean. Now characters, if it comes to, basically we want to represent one single symbol, that symbol can be anything. It can be A, it can be D, it can be 1, it can be anything. One single symbol, maybe the rupee symbol, maybe the dollar sign, then we use characters. But if we want to, I want to store a sentence in one variable, then there is a separate thing, it's called strings. We'll deal with strings later. But right now, if you want to declare one particular symbol, and we want to declare that symbol and we want to store it in a variable, then we use the character data type. How do we write a character? Or you can say, what is the keyword to define that this particular variable is a character? It is char, char. I'll write this in brackets. Char. You are writing char in your program. This means that you are defining a variable as a character data type and you are going to store one symbol in that variable. Simple to understand. Next, we are having boolean. Now, boolean has only two possible values to store. Boolean can only help us store two values, either true or false. We have already studied boolean logic in, you can say, class 1, 2. It's something very simple which is taught now even in primary school. So I hope so my audience knows that what is boolean, what is boolean logic. But yet I'll just tell it that boolean basically is a data type which can help us store either true, true, or it can help us store false. It can help us store false. Now, where are we going to use this true and where are we going to use this false? Answer is simple. While making decisions. If we want a decision, or you can say a step to occur, we'll say true. If we want it not to occur, we'll say false. Now I'll again say that this is something which we'll dive in deeper later. For now, let's understand it like this only. Boolean is a data type and it helps us to store true and false. Coming on my Java program and showing how do we use variables and data types. For example, I want to store number 4. How will I do so? I have to use one of them, either byte or short or int or long. Let's say I'm using int. Fine. I'm using int. So I have to declare a variable also. I cannot say that int is equals to 4. This is wrong. And if I'll compile it, it's going to throw an error. Why? Because I have not given any name to my variable. Int is a data type. It is not a variable. It is not a memory location. Okay, it's just a data type telling that how much space the variable is going to take up. I yet have to give the variable a name and I'm naming it A. Int A is equals to 4. So now what have I done? I'll again come to this paint. I'll quickly scroll down, or rather I'll make this area big. Fine. Coming here. Now what have I done? I have made a variable. In that variable, I have stored a value. The value is 4. I have named this variable A. I have given a name to this variable. The name given to this variable is A. Fine. And this A has been declared as an, it has been said that A is storing an integer value. It is having a characteristic. The characteristic is of int data type. Fine. So int is the data type allocated to this. So A will have only that much space sufficient to store an int data type value. It's comparatively lesser. For example, I have not written int, I have written long, then this much space will be given. For example, I have not written int, I have written short. And as you know, short provides less space, then this will be the size of the variable. If I have written byte, then this will be the size of the variable. Simple to understand. Depending on how big the value is, we allocate the data type. We have allocated int, so this is our variable. The name of the variable is A because we have named it A over here. And when I am going to remove this and I am going to write over here A, and I am going to click on compile, I am going to come here, execute it, you will see that the value coming is 4. Simple explanation, I have created a variable A, in that I have created a variable, I have named that variable A, I have stored 4 in that variable is of int data type. Later I have come here and I have printed A. Now I have not printed A, I have written A over here. The value which is stored in the variable named A is going to be printed. A is storing 4, so 4 will be printed, not A. If I want to print A, then I will have to make it a character. Now this character A is going to get printed. Now you will see the magic here. Now you will see that A is going to get printed. I am quickly coming on the terminal. You can see A has got printed. I am removing this. Then it means I am referring to this A. If I am putting this, then it means that I have to, that Java has to print this character A. Simple to understand. Next, if I am making it double and I am quickly compiling it, then you can see again no syntax error. But how come? I right now said that double is dealing with decimal values. Now you know that automatically 4, if I am saying 4, then 4 is automatically equals to 4.0. 0 is something which we assume which is presumptuous, so it is not going to throw an error. But if I am putting it 4.2, then also it's not going to throw any error. Now if I am changing it to int data type, then you will see it's throwing an error, because 4.2 cannot be stored in a variable that is of data type int, because this is a decimal value. Simple to understand. Now let me create some more. Short int, byte long. At this stage I will say use them interchangeably. We will deal with the differences with the specific definitions later, because they are very complex to understand at this stage. Okay, moving from numeric to, let's say I am declaring float as well. Here I am declaring float, the name of the variable is b, and inside b I am storing 4.567. Now you see there is an error. Why? Because I have not placed a semicolon. Semicolon is the terminator of a Java, you can say, a line, and we need to place it whenever we are ending a line of code. Now you see I intentionally made this error, 4.567. Float cannot store such a big value. I have to reduce this value. And now you see it is yet not storing. I have to decrease it. No, I think there's some error. Just a minute. Yeah, compiling it and let's see what the error is. Possible loss of conversion from float, from double to float. Okay, understood. We have to use double along with 4.5. Double b is equals to 4.5, simple. And if we have to use float, then float c is equals to 4.5f, and now you'll see it is not going to throw any sort of error. We have to use f whenever we are declaring a variable as float. Yeah, so this is a condition. While using float we have to write f. I forgot to tell this is something important. You are using float, you have to put f here. This is not something with double. If I put d here, then also no error is going to occur. You can see no error is occurring. But if I don't put d, then also everything is fine. But for float, f over here is a must. Now next, coming here, let's talk about some non-numeric data types. I am talking about boolean, and boolean is a data type. I am naming the variable d. Okay, and I can store in it true or false only. I am writing true here. You can see no error is occurring, everything is fine. I am not putting true here, I am writing t, and I am compiling it. You can see error is happening. Instead of this, I am writing, for example, 64, and compiling it, again error is happening. Simple to understand. Fine, but yeah, this is something that for boolean you only have true or false. You can see I have written true, nothing is happening. I'm typing in false, again it's accepting it. Simple to understand. Lastly, char. Now char is again a data type, I told you, can store any single value. So I will let's say I'm putting e1, char e1, char e2, and char e3. Fine. And I'm going to store 3 symbols in each. Fine. Coming to char e1, over here I wish to store, let's say I wish to store here h. Okay, I am storing here h. In e2, I wish to store a number. Let's say I am wishing to store 4. Now, something which needs to be told here that I can store 4 like this also. If I want, I can store 4 like this also. It cannot throw an error. I am compiling it. But before I am putting something in e3, I am putting the dollar sign over here. Okay, so dollar sign. Where is the dollar? Yeah, dollar sign. When closing it, compiling it, no error is occurring. Now, when talking about numbers, if I put a single quote here and a single quote here, and again I compile it, no error is going to occur. I am removing both the single quotes, then also no error is going to occur. This is something you can put a whole number as it is in a character, no error is going to occur. Talking about decimal values, you see on your own. 4.5 I have done, I am compiling it, it will throw an error. For 4.5, even if I will put double quotes here and here, then also it is going to throw an error because these are 3 separate symbols and character can only take up one symbol. I can take any symbol which I want. Let's say I am taking an asterisk, then I am compiling it. No error because it's a single symbol. 2 asterisks and we'll see the error. Simple to understand. Boolean you guys have already known. Now, lastly, in this episode, I want to tell you all that how can we declare a variable. For example, I am declaring a variable. Let's say I am writing here long. And inside long, instead of writing a big number, I can write a big number also. Let's say I am declaring long f and I am declaring long g. Okay. And in f, I am storing a very long number. Let's say I am storing, this is the number which I am storing in f. And in g, I am storing a small number. It doesn't matter. Code is going to work as it's working. Fine. If I want, instead of storing a number in a variable, I can store another variable. In g, I can write that I am storing a. And I click on compile. No error is occurring. Many will say that how come is it possible, because long is dealing with numeric values only and a is not a numeric value. I would like to tell you, over here a is referring to this a. So when I am saying long g is equals to a, I am saying that long g is storing value 4. You guys don't believe me, I am coming here, I am writing g, I am clicking on compile, then coming here and executing the code. Fine. And you can see value is 4. Why is the value 4? System.out.println g, it is coming here. Now in g, what we have written? We have written that inside g, we are storing the value stored in a. And what is a storing? A is storing 4. Simple to understand. And yeah, this was all for this episode. We discussed about data types. Next video is going to be about data types again. We are going to discuss everything in depth. We are also going to talk about some Java rules. Upcoming video is going to be all about theory. It's going to be about understanding Java rather than coding Java. And yeah, do let me know in the comments that did you guys like this video. I hope so, that this was something very informative. This was a new concept. And if yes, then please do like this video and subscribe to our channel. I hope so that this video was something which was quite beneficial for you all beginners. And if you guys want to support me, I will simply suggest, please subscribe to my channel. Very soon, I will come back with another amazing video. Till then, goodbye.